Hi there, and thank you for tuning in. Shooting in manual mode on a Nikon Z6 Mark II is what I'm going to demonstrate here. And the first thing you need to do is to turn the mode dial over here to manual, M for manual. Subject to which display you have selected here, you will be able to see that it tells you you are in manual mode. You can see here now it flicks between aperture, priority, and manual. So in some displays, also here you can see it says manual top left. In other displays you cannot see it. The first thing that happens when you shoot it, put it into manual mode, is that your camera's metering system continues to work, but it stops selecting either aperture or shutter speed for you. You have to do that now. And it shows you here on a scale. As soon as you move in and out of manual mode, you can see the scale appears here, and this is the exposure scale showing you if you, according to the camera, have managed to get a what I would call technically correct exposed picture. You can see here there's a bar just below the zero here towards the minus, meaning that I'm slightly underexposed here. Let me see if I can, then I'm just made it worse, but you can see now I got a little bit better. Now it should be spot on. So towards the plus, it's overexposed. Towards the minus, is underexposed. A good thing to keep an eye on this scale. And you can also see that this scale is a clear indication that now you are in manual exposure mode. The two values to control when you are in manual exposure mode is aperture and shutter speed. And you control the shutter speed here on the rear command dial. You can see here as I change it, you can see both that it shows down here that it's being changed, and also it shows up here in the top LCD what the shutter speed is. Here I'm at 1/90th of a second. Here I am at 1/30th, right? So you change the shutter speed here. The aperture is on the front command dial, sits right here, and you can see here as I'm changing it, it also affects the exposure. So that's really all there is to it in terms of shutter speed and aperture. What about good old ISO, you may say then, because ISO in the old days was also part of the exposure. Today it's more a post-processing thing, I would say, and camera internal post-processing thing. So what your camera does is, according to your ISO value, it amplifies the signal that you have received, the light signal. So the sensor reads the value and then it applies a factor to what it has read, and that is in fact what is stored on your memory card. It is not, does not affect the sensitivity of the sensor as some think. It's just like if you have an old car radio, you know, where the signal is weak and you turn up the volume, it doesn't get much better than that, because you're both amplifying the signal and the noise. And it's a little bit the same with the with ISO. You amplify both the signal and the noise, and that's why if you shoot at crazy high ISO values, then you probably will see grainy pictures with potentially also washed out colors. It's simply because you're amplifying a very weak signal where your camera cannot tell the difference between signal and noise. But if you want to play with ISO, you push the ISO button, and again that changes the value of these exactly the same two buttons. So the rear command dial here, you select, you can see the ISO value. Now I'm at, I believe 100 is the base value. You can go lower than that, but I think this is an artificial ISO value. I think the base ISO value for this camera is 100. It's a little bit different for the Z7. I believe it's 65 or so. But basically you just do exactly the same here. You can see you change the values by turning the rear command dial. The front command dial switches between auto ISO and, you can say, more manual ISO. So in auto ISO, the camera will try to set the ISO value so that the exposure is correct. You see, it maintains the scale, but if I, for instance, change the shutter speed, it will just change the auto ISO or the ISO value to arrive at a correct exposure. This can go a little bit crazy if you select something where you, for instance, stop down your aperture and you have a relatively short shutter speed. You can see here now it's at ISO 40,000, which is of course a very high value. So if I take it out of auto ISO, you can see immediately the LCD or the rear LCD goes black, and you can see the metering scale here starts flashing and goes through the floor, right? And you can also see the histogram. So if I take it back in auto ISO, you can see now it compensates and it looks a little bit better. There are actually three ways you can see if you have a roughly right exposure. One is the scale here, as I mentioned. Another is if you toggle between the different display options. I like the one with the histogram, also in the viewfinder. Here you can see how your light is distributed, and you can also see if you're very lefty, for instance, then you're probably losing details in the shadows. So that's a second indication where what your exposure looks like. And the third is simply you have what you see is what you get, meaning that if I just take this one out of, you can see it turns completely black, and it's a preview telling me that if I push the shutter now, I won't record much, I will just get a black frame. This is, of course, a strong indication something is very wrong, but I just want to show you this, that you have, to some extent, what you see is what you get, so the camera can predict the exposure and show you that both in the electronic viewfinder and in the rear LCD. So you have a lot of help with a modern mirrorless camera in terms of getting the exposure right also in manual mode. The last thing I want to show you is the metering modes, and this is just for completeness. To be quite honest, you have four metering modes: matrix, center weighted, spot metering, and highlight weighted. I think the first and the last are the most useful. 99.9% of the time I'm shooting in matrix metering. I think it's the most intelligent metering mode, but of course it is an average. And the camera looks in the entire scene and based on that tries to figure out what's the correct exposure. If you have center weighted, then it puts more weight to the center, as the name says. This is good for portraits, maybe if you have someone who's backlit by a strong sun or something like that, you may want to use this one. I think, to be quite honest, this is more because it gives some backward compatibility with older Nikon DSLRs. Spot metering, that is if you have an area where you know it's very important exactly that area is exposed correctly and you don't care too much about the rest, you can move the spot point exactly to where you want it to be and then meter according to that. And the last one here is highlight weighted metering, where the camera makes sure that you have no blown out parts, but you may lose details in the shadows. So it's a way of securing you don't lose details in the highlights, but you probably, if it's a high dynamic range scene, you probably will lose details in the shadows. So, subject to your liking, you can choose between these four. As I said, matrix metering is my preference, but we are in personal preference territory here. So, of course, select the one that works the best for you. Another thing that can be useful is if you go into metering exposure in the custom settings menu, that is B as Bravo. You can see here the first one, B1, you can set the size of the steps you take so that you step 1/3 step or half a step and or stop, as I would actually call them. So a little bit subject to how granularly you want to walk up and down the different options for aperture, shutter speed, and ISO, you can select these two values. Why we cannot walk in full steps or full stops as we could back with the DSLRs is a mystery to me, but at least you can select between these two. Again, a little thing for personal preference. Okay, that's it from me. Hope this was useful and not too long. As always, happy shooting. Take care. Bye-bye.